St. Francis de Sales said, "Faith is like a bright ray of sunlight. It enables us to see God in all things as well as all things in God." For our guest today, Father Leo Song, his faith is as bright as the sun. Father Song was born in Seoul, South Korea, raised in Bayside, Queens, and he was educated for the priesthood at the seminaries in Washington and Rome. Father Song once said, "The priesthood of Jesus Christ is an enormous gift and blessing from God." Father Song is serving as an associate pastor at St. Rose of Lima Parish in Massapequa. Today he will share with us his vocation story here on It's a Wonderful Life. Welcome back to It's a Wonderful Life. I'm joined today by Father Leo Song, the associate pastor at St. Rose of Lima and the most newliest ordained priest for the Diocese of Rockville Center. Father Leo, welcome to the show.
It's great to be here, Father Joe. Thanks for having me.
It's my pleasure. Father Leo, I think one of the things that the people of God want to know is, like, where does this vocation come from? Where did somebody, like, you know, think about becoming a priest for the first time? You did not grow up here on Long Island. Mm-hmm. You were born in Korea. Maybe you could tell us a little bit about that journey of life and family.
Sure. I was born in Seoul, South Korea. And in 1988, my father made the decision to move our family to the United States. So we immigrated to New York. And you know, my parents, very faithful, thank God, that they were role models of the faith for my sister and I, you know, worshiping every Sunday, but also involved in the parish life. My father, a faithful member of the choir, and my mother in different ministries. And so that really made a big impact on me growing up. And once I myself started to get involved in the parish life, first as involved in young in youth group and the young adult group, and as a catechist, that's when things really started to take off for me, and my heart was being prepared to answer the call to the priesthood. And it was really a combination of my family and being involved in the parish, and it was different members of the parish, from, you know, priests to religious to you know, good faithful lay men and women who would you know, see this young man involved in the parish life, mass every Sunday, and, you know, their invitation, loving, gentle invitation to me to consider a vocation to the priesthood. And some people even saying, "You got a vocation, what are you waiting for? Go to seminary you know, right away."
That's so awesome.
Yeah.
You know, so often sometimes those seeds are planted very, very young. You went to college, Illinois, right? Were you in Illinois, were you thinking about the priesthood then?
No, definitely not. When I went to college in the University of Illinois, you know, unfortunately I fell away from my faith and I didn't practice my faith in my college years. Thank God when I came back home for the breaks, like summer and Christmas, that's when I got plugged back in. But yeah, due to number of reasons, you know, namely my own sinfulness, I didn't practice my faith the way that God was calling me to, was asking me to in college. And, you know, no thoughts, no plans about the priesthood. I had my own plans. Okay. I wanted the good life, you know, I wanted the wonderful life. And for me, what that looked like was a beautiful wife, beautiful children, lots of children, a big house, fancy cars and toys, a lot of money. That was my plan.
Okay. And at Illinois, what did you study? What was your career? Because you did come a little bit later into the seminary. So what were you doing just prior to that?
Yeah, I studied economics, and, you know, part of that was because I wanted to be a wealthy, successful businessman. And so after graduating college, I worked for a year in logistics with the import-export industry. But after a year of that, it got to be boring. It wasn't doing anything for me. It was so different than my experience of ministry at the parish. And I said, you know, I have to change it up. So from there, I moved on to the business and operation side of garment manufacturing in the fashion industry,
okay.
The garment industry in Manhattan. And certainly that was a lot more enjoyable and more fun.
So you mean like the fashion world where like the cameras are coming in and there's like models walking up and down, like the garments that went on them, yeah. That's the stuff that you were doing?
I was more behind the scenes because I was the one in charge of making the clothes.
Wow.
for that to happen. And but at the end of the day, still, there was this emptiness and longing. Like, I would work hard, but at the end of the day, like, what did I accomplish? And, you know, it was to make more money for my clients or my boss, but it wasn't feeding, nourishing my soul. And again, this was such a contrast to my experience of serving God and His people in the ministry, in different ministries at the parish level. And so that's when I decided I need a different career path. I still wasn't open to the priesthood, even though there were these people at the parish inviting me to consider the vocation. But, you know, I'm so, my heart was so, it's like a rock, you know, it was ice. It wasn't ready. And, but I still wanted the beautiful family and the house and wanting to be a good father, to be there for my children and not letting my career take over, like dictate, you know, the time that I would have to spend with my children. I decided to go towards the path of, in the medical field, particularly physical therapy. And so I went back to school to get the credits that I needed, applied, got in, and, you know, 3.5 years of PT school. But then it was at the third year, and during this whole time, I was falling in love with my faith. Because I had that responsibility to learn more about the faith as a catechist at my home parish. But more importantly, falling in love with the person of Jesus Christ. Mm. And, you know, the invitation of the people asking me to consider the vocation to the priesthood, it never went away. It was lingering, percolating. And there got to be, it finally came to a time when, like, Jesus had my heart. I was in love. And I said, Lord, as impossible as it might seem, if you are calling me to be your priest, despite my weaknesses, my sinfulness, I'm open to that. And once I made that decision to be open, then things became clearer and clearer. Mm. And yeah, the rest is history. I contacted the vocation director and through Monsignor Jim Blonde, he connected me to Bishop Murphy. I met with him, and yeah, I told him my entire story, and he was happy to accept me to sponsor me as a seminarian.
Well, we're all very happy that you came in to serve with us. So you studied in Washington and Rome, so that was your experience of seminary, of like pre-theology and theology. So you can obviously grow up speaking Korean, English, a little Italian. Could you say Mass like an Italian if you had to?
I could.
So you have this incredible experience. And then all of a sudden you're ordained this past June and you come into St. Rose of Lima. Tell us a little about that, newly ordained guy.
when I was in formation for the priesthood, I had my expectations of what the priesthood would be like, you know, and I envisioned that certainly happiness, blessedness, you know, a lot of love. But my actual experience of being in the parish and the love that I've received from the people of God, the good people there, has by far exceeded my expectations. And it's been a wonderful life, truly.
No pun intended.
A good life, you know, the good life, of course, the good life that I was dreaming of as a young man, You know, that was my plan, right? But once God's plan and my plan aligned, then it became really, truly the best life that I could ever imagine for myself. A life within and through Christ at the parish, being an instrument of the love of God for the people, celebrating, administering the sacraments. There's no greater thing than I could do every day than to celebrate the holy sacrifice of the Mass, to call down the power of the Holy Spirit, to change bread and wine into the Eucharist. Such a mystery, such a gift, such a privilege that we have as priests have, and to be the recipient of the love, the outpouring of love from the people, you know, and to experience their thirst for the love of God, and for me to be able to feed them and nourish them sacramentally. There's no greater life.
As a housemate of yours now, I recently moved into St. Rose of Lima, and I know that you have to do the dishes, you make me do push-ups, that kind of stuff, because I'm the low man on the totem pole.
I want you to be healthy and to live that good life,
that's
too.
That's right. But it's also one of the biggest parishes, and you spoke about like being a father, and there's a lot going on with the youth and religious education, that kind of thing. Can you speak to any firsts that you, when you came into the parish, whether it be with the young people, and you desired like to be that father, that one of those first where you're like, I'm truly experiencing what it means to be a father to the people of God?
So I've been looking at my my life as a parish priest. A lot of times in prayer, like, am I doing what a good father would be doing for his children? And it seems to me that one of the most important things for a father to do for his children is to be present to whatever needs that they have, to be available for them. And as a diocesan priest, to be radically available to them and to feed and to help them and to guide them in the faith with whatever needs that they have. And so I've been asked as one of my primary responsibilities is to look after our faith formation program, religious education. And so to be available to not only the catechists, which we certainly have a lot of them, to form them so that they can form and catechize and teach our younger brothers and sisters. That's been a great responsibility, but also a privilege, and the way that God has called me to grow at St. Rose of Lima in Massapequa.
The life of the priesthood is to bring the presence of Christ into the world. Father Leo Song spoke so beautifully about availability and being present to those that he serves. Each time he's called in many different ways, whether it's to be served at a baptism or at Mass or with religious education. He is present as a father. So often, Jesus calls in many different ways, cultures, and languages. But when we respond with love, we will always live a wonderful life. Thanks for being with us today. As Catholics responding to the challenge of Bishop Barris to encourage dramatic missionary growth in the diocese, we use all forms of media in promoting the gospel, including television and social media. If you want to know more about any of the priests we featured here or have any questions or comments, you can email us at vocations@drvc.org, or you can visit our website at acalltoholiness.com. See you next time right here on It's a Wonderful Life.